Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
And what a blessing and a privilege it is for us to be here this morning. God has been good to us, amen?
Amen.
As I've always said, he has kept us safe. We are still alive. And I just hope in our right minds, amen?
Amen.
And if that's the case, that's enough reason to give him all the praise, the honor, and the glory, amen?
Amen.
But remind us that decisions are never pre-planned. Every decision that we make has never been pre-planned. However, what has been pre-planned is the outcome of every decision we make. The result is already waiting on us. If you obey, you shall live. If you disobey, you shall die. Amen. That's why we have the freedom to choose. Decisions is left with us. Two young lads said that today we're going to get Mr. Socrates. And they came up with a plan and they said, there is no way he can get out of this one. And they said, here's what we're going to do. We're going to catch another bird, hold that bird in our hands, and we're going to approach Mr. Socrates, the great Socrates, and say to him, is the bird dead or is it alive? And if he says that the bird is dead, we're going to present a live bird. If he says that the bird is alive, we're going to squeeze his neck and present a dead bird. And they concluded that there is no way he's going to be able to get out of this one. So they caught up the bird, and they approached Mr. Socrates, and they held their hands behind their backs. And they asked Mr. Socrates the question, Mr. Socrates, is the bird dead or is it alive? He thought for a moment, and then he looked at the young two lads, and he said to them, the answer is in your hands. And I am saying to us today that the answer is in our hands. Amen?
Amen.
Choose you this day whom you will serve. If God be God, serve him. And if Baal be your God, serve him. Amen. Joshua said, as for me and my house. But let's not go too fast. He said, as for me. Amen. And then he includes his household. He said, as for me and my house. But first priority is that if my household doesn't follow, he said, as for me. And then my house will serve the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
So we must make that decision, every single one of us. God does not save by groups, he saves by individuals. Amen.
Amen?
Good families will be saved by individuals. Amen? Every decision we make is not pre-planned, but the outcome is waiting on us. So I'm here to suggest to us, choose life. So that you can live, amen?
Amen.
But why will you die? As I look at the news in some places of this country and around the world, it seems as though this virus is getting the better hand. And there are more cases that seem to be popping up and more deaths. It's called COVID-19. And I want to also remind us that there is also Psalm 91.
Amen.
Amen. God always can counteract the counterfeit, what do you say?
Amen.
Because he says to us, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Amen. I will serve the Lord. He is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in him will I trust. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler, and from the noise of pestilence he shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings he shall thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Amen. Amen. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flies by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness. 1,000 shall fall on thy side, and 10,000 on thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with an eye shall thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. Amen. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For, and the devil quoted this passage to Christ, taken from Psalm 91. For he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder. The young lion and the dragon shall thou trample on the feet. Amen. Amen. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he has known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will build him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. So God always can counteract the counterfeit, because with every trial, with every crisis, there is a message that he has given to us. Amen. If only we turn our eyes upon Jesus. Now, for those of you who love titles, I have entitled the message, The Levirate Marriage and the KR. Now, I don't want to be mysterious, but I love trying to get you to think. And it's a good thing. What do you say? I'm going to deal with the first part first, and then we're going to go to the second part, the Levirate marriage. And I turn your attention to the second law. That's the book of Deuteronomy. Dos means second, and namos means law. It's the second reading of the law. Deuteronomy chapter 25. And we're going to pick it up from verse 5. Now, if your Bibles came with you, say amen.
Amen.
If it did not come with you, say, oh me. The amens need to have all the oh me's. Amen.
Amen.
Psalm 119 and verse 105 says, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Amen.
Amen.
In order to have the lamp, you need to have fuel, and it also needs to be lighted. The fuel represents the Holy Spirit, and the light represents the Word of God. Amen.
Amen.
Deuteronomy chapter 25, reading from verse 5. And I want you to consider what God is saying to us in this passage. If brethren dwell together, and one of them die, and have no child, the wife of the dead shall not marry without unto a stranger. Her husband's brother shall go in unto her and take her to him to wife, and perform the duty of an husband's brother unto her. And it shall be that the firstborn which she beareth shall succeed in the name of his brother which is dead, and his name be not put out of Israel. And if the man like not to take his brother's wife, then let his brother's wife go up to the gate unto the elders and say, my husband's brother refused to raise up unto his brother a name in Israel. He will not perform the duty of my husband's brother. Then the elders of his city shall call him and speak unto him, and if he stand to it, in other words, if he does not decide to change his mind, and say, I like not to take her. Verse 9, then shall his brother's wife come unto him in the presence of the elders and loose his shoes from off his foot and spit in his face and shall answer and say, so shall it be done unto that man that will not build up his brother's house. When God brought the children of Israel out of Egypt with a strong and mighty hand, a great deliverance, and when they found themselves in the land of Canaan, a land flowing with milk and honey, each of them were given property. They did not have to buy it. It was given to them. And it was passed down from father to son, from generation to generation, until the coming of the Messiah. Until the Messiah shall come. It was an inheritance. Now, one of the reasons why there is no peace in the Middle East is because the Palestinians are saying, we were here before you came. And the Israelis are saying, God gave it to us by promise. But you cannot have peace without the Prince of Peace. Amen?
Yes.
That's why they are going to pieces. If you want to have peace in your life, you got to have Jesus. What do you say? Amen?
Yes.
And my God is a loving Heavenly Father. Amen?
Yes.
God's intent that His law and His precepts, His teaching, should not circulate within the context of Israel, but all through the Gentile world. Amen?
Amen?
That the good news should be given to all men, because God desired that all men be saved. What do you say?
Amen.
Israel were a theocracy. God was their king, He was their leader, He was their government. Sometimes tragedy will happen in life, and we always want to become like the others. Whenever any traveler came into town and they would inquire of Israel, where is your God? They were supposed to point to the sanctuary. There is our king, there is our leader, there is our God. Amen? But they wanted to be like the other nations. God should be supreme. He should be priority. He should be number one, first place, first preference in our lives. Beside Him, there is no other. Amen?
Amen.
He should be closest to every single one of us. Now, this law is a very unique law that was in Israel. If a husband and wife should dwell together, and in the process of time, they could not have any children, or they didn't have the opportunity, the privilege to have children, and the husband should die, the law states that the next of kin, the brother of the dead husband, should take the brother's wife to wife and perform the duty of a husband to her. And the first child is not his, but the first child belongs to the dead brother. That they should carry on the heritage, or the name would not be blotted out from the chronicles of Israel. That was the law in Israel. Amen? If the brother should refuse to take her to his wife, to be his wife, Then she shall take him to the Supreme Court, that is the elders in Israel, to the gate. And she shall loose the shoes from off his feet and spit in his face, because he refused to take her to wife. What a law. Now, when critics read some of these laws in the Old Testament, they mock and they scorn. But there was a reason for this. Amen? Now we're going to pick it up in the second part of the message. By the way, God loves us, what he said. Amen? Now, all of us loves a good story. And there are many stories in the scriptures. Amen? I turn your attention to the book of Ruth. What book did I say? Ruth, chapter 1. And there's a very beautiful story in the book of Ruth. Verse 1 reads, "And it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled, that there was a famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons." Now, in this verse, there is an oxymoron, because Beth means house of. Bethlehem means house of bread. Bethsaida means house of fish. Bethel means the Elohim is a contraction of El, is a contraction of Elohim, means house of God. Bethany means house of mercy or house of hospitality. That's where Mary and Martha and Lazarus resided. And whenever Jesus wanted a good meal, he would find himself at that vacation, amen? Because they were good cooks. That side, that is where Peter and Andrew came from. And Philip, house of fish. Bethel, house of God, and so on and so on. But in this verse it says that there was a famine in Bethlehem. How can you say the same sentence, famine and house of bread, in the same sentence? You see, Bethlehem was known for its granary, its wheat and barley. There was no lack of bread. Entire nations would come and get bread from Bethlehem. If you were short of food and you had a little money, you would go to Bethlehem and buy bread. Something that will stick to the walls of your stomach. Amen? Because an empty bag cannot stand, and a full bag cannot bear. But you had enough to sustain life. What do you say? Amen. Bethlehem, house of bread. But there was a famine in Bethlehem. And there was a family here, and they decided to get rid of the little that they had and go to the land of Moab. Now, Bethlehem was the house of bread. The family was Elimelech, Naomi, Mahlon, and Chilion. They decided to go to the land of Moab. Now, when Israel was fleeing Egypt, the nation that was most adamant in the opposition to Israel was the Moabites. Moabites were descendants of Lot, with his incestuous relationship with his daughters. And because of the opposition to Israel, God had said to the Moabites, it was unlawful for some of the Moabites to enter certain parts of Israel. In Bethlehem, the land of Canaan, because there was opposition to God's people. Whenever individuals oppose God's people their consequences. A friend of mine, as the old Negro spiritual would say, trouble doesn't last always, but joy comes in the morning. What do you say? Even the problems come and the wicked seems to be prospering, hold on to the unchanging hand of God. He who sees never gives up. He has an unforgettable memory, what do you say?
Amen.
Because he loves every single one of us. So they decided to go down to the land of Moab. That's where Balak was king. And he asked Balaam to curse the people of God. And whenever he opened his mouth, a blessing came up. Because God is in control, amen?
Amen?
You cannot curse what God has blessed. Never forget this. God said in Abraham, all the families of the earth will be blessed. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse them that curse thee. So how come you're going to curse something that God has already blessed?
Amen.
It is impossible, amen? And when God blesses something or someone, it's well blessed. Make no mistake about it, friend of mine. If God be for you, who can be against you? Because you have decided to change camps and put your hands in the hands of Christ, the devil cannot touch any one of God's children unless God gives him permission. And if God allows it, it's because it's your size. Amen? Because God sees something in you that needs improving. Amen? You see, you and I are not that special. We are not that important. That God has to invent special trials just for you. Amen?
Amen?
Apart from Jesus, we are nothing, we have nothing, and we give nothing. On the other hand, God is everything, he has everything, and he gives everything.
Amen.
What makes us important is the blood of Christ.
Amen.
Apart from Jesus, we are absolutely filthy rags. All our righteousness is like basura. It's dark. It's filthy rags in the sight of God. It's not talking about all the good we do. It's not talking about all the bad we do. It's talking about all the good we do. Amen?
Amen.
It's filthy rags in the sight of God. God accepts us because of Jesus. Now this family, the unthinkable happened while they were in Moab. A tragedy took place. And the Bible says that Elimelech and his two sons died. They stayed 10 years in Moab. And during that time, the sons married Moabite women. Amen? But in the process of time, the two sons and the father died. Now, can you imagine the crisis that these women found themselves in? Three widows struggling to make ends meet. Actually, they were living from hand to mouth. No one to provide for them. No one to protect them. No one to care for them. No one to sustain them. It was a very sad situation. But now we heard that God has visited Bethlehem, the house of bread. And now there was bread in Bethlehem. And she said to her daughter-in-laws, which I believe have grown at this point very attached to her, they said to her, I'm going back to Bethlehem. You need to stay here among your own people, among your own gods. And as she began journeying back to Bethlehem, these daughter-in-laws were following her. And she had already said to them, you need to stay here because I'm old. I cannot have more sons. I'm past the age of childbearing. There is no more sons in my womb to give you any more husbands. Amen. So she painted a picture that will in somehow cause impression on them to stay back in Moab. Amen. Are you with me so far?
Yes.
So why are you still wondering what the care means?
Yeah.
Well, you soon know. Amen. You see, God loves us, what you say.
Yeah.
Not everything is revealed, what you say. Amen. In time. Even Jesus said to his disciples, I have much to tell you, but you can't take it right now. Amen. But in time, it shall be. Verse 6 says, then she arose with her daughters-in-law, that she might return from the country of Moab, for she had heard that the country of Moab, how that the Lord has visited his people in giving them bread. You see, trouble doesn't last always, friend of mine. Things might be hard today, but God will surely bless you. Amen. God is a loving God. And she said to her daughters-in-law while they were following, she turned back and said to them, I told you to stay among your people. I have no place to put you in. I have no shelter. I have no job. I have no security. I have no one to take care of me, let alone you. One of the daughters-in-law decided to return back. Who was it? Orpah decided to go back to her people and to her gods. And by the way, that was the decision that she made. Her god in Moab was Chemosh, an idol god. But Naomi pressed on with, and Ruth pressed on with Naomi, amen? And Naomi decided to give her a face-to-face confrontation. Because sometimes when you don't listen the first time, we say we need to have a man-to-man talk, amen? A face-to-face confrontation with this daughter-in-law. And she said, you need to stay with your people. But in verse 16, it says, these words have come down through time. These words of entreaty. And Ruth said, entreat me not to leave you.